chance of punishing Obzon. Both these players 10-3, still in top 8 contention. And round number 14 will be underway here from New Jersey. It will start with Duke, and he's got himself a Scalding Tarn. We watched Keating beat Dylan Donegan the last round yesterday. That was round number 9 to walk into day number 2 at 8-1. 10-3 now, but still in top 8 contention, as mentioned. As Duke is going to sacrifice the Scalding Tarn, going to search up a basic island. Now he'll sacrifice the Arid Mesa. He'll get himself a Tundra. And perhaps we'll see a turn two counterbalance here.
I think this is the first non-basic land I've seen Reid have in play over the course of this tournament. His list has a ton of basics. He's put a high priority on fetching them early and often.
6 islands, 3 plains. And even has a basic mountain in the sideboard. There is counterbalance. No top to go along with it just yet. Now, Keating's deck actually is one that lines up pretty well against counterbalance, I would say. 4 abrupt decays in there.
And just a healthy spread of costs.
Yeah.
So this is not a problematic card for Keating most games, but if he can't answer it, it still has an opportunity to blind flip, or with the help of Brainstorms and Divining Tops, counter a good portion of his deck.
Wasteland will take care of that Tundra. Duke will just play a Flooded Strand, pass the turn back. Keating with a Scrubland, I believe.
Yes.
That and Savannah always looked so alike to me. Duke with just a plane, so he'll pass the turn back over to Tom. Tom is going to cycle a Baron Moor on the instep.
Nice.
Knight of the Reliquary, the draw off the cycle.
2 of those in there.
Sure.
For whatever reason.
Life and alone, man.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Get that cycle engine online.
Excuse me, I forgot. I'm so used to Tranquil Thicket being the hand in question. Baron Moor works as well.
Grove of the Burn Willow is the play. That'll give Keating green mana for Abrupt Decay, assuming he has one in hand. Duke gonna sacrifice a basic island. Excuse me, sacrifice a Flood Strand to search up a basic island.
Reid has a bit of a history of being Jund guy, too.
Oh, yeah.
When this deck really came on the map, the Grand Prix, Legacy Grand Prix in Denver a couple years ago, that was Reid.
Yep. Time for a Brainstorm. Jace the Mind Sculptor, Scalding Tarn, Swords of Plowshares are the cards that have been added to the grip. 2 cards will have to go back.
So I'm sure Duke can appreciate the opening here from the other side of the table. Some odd mixture of dual lands, a cycling land.
Not just waiting for Bloodbraid Elf, right?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Yes! Yes.
Reid going to make a prediction.
I wonder if he knows.
It's unclear if he knows. Oh, wow. He did know that there was a Jace there. Isn't that just the luckiest
so
thing?
Nice.
The one of predict, it really gets me going.
Mm-hmm.
I'm right there with you. Gonna search up a basic plains now, Will Duke. Is it time for Jace next? Yes, it is. I got a feeling that elevator's going up there.
Yep, get outside of Lightning Bolt range.
He'll Fate Seal himself. Take a look at the top card. Gonna leave it on top, pass the turn back over to Keating. Abrupt Decay gonna go after counterbalance. Duke will get the gain of life in the exchange. Counterbalance down. But Keating's got to contend with the powerful Planeswalker now.
And this is a card his deck does not line up very well against. Can't easily get creatures on the table. Can't easily burn it out. No clean answers like Maelstrom Pulse. This is going to be a problem.
Caracas is here. Here's Dark Confidant. And now there's Chalice of the Void on 1. We'll see if this resolves. And it appears that it will. So, Swords, Brainstorm, Sensei's Divine Top. Look to be off the table now.
Not a bad card for Keating to have here. Reid with Swords of Plowshares in hand. If Reid could simply Swords the Dark Confidant, he can continue to Fate Seal a Brainstorm with Jace. Now he's got to figure something else out.
Sensei's Divine Top the draw. Not ideal. However, Reid does have a copy of Council's Judgment that can take care of the Chalice. That's exactly what's going to take place. And now Duke is going to Brainstorm. So 3 cards coming, 2 will have to go back. That Chalice will have to be exiled, of course, from the Council's Judgment, so we'll make sure the graveyard is appropriate there for Tom Keating. Reid gonna have to put two cards back from Brainstorm here. Looking for a white source, probably to swords. That Dark Confidant, don't let the card advantage engine get out of control. And there's Tundra, there is swords. That'll take care of Dark Confidant. Keating will gain two life in the exchange. Now here's the Sensei's Divining Top, and it's a nice turn there for Duke. Back to Keating we go. He's gonna need some big draws here because he's falling behind pretty quickly.
Let's draw another copy of Chalice so we can run back the same turn he just had. And it's not like Reed's deck is flush with that many copies of Council's Judgment, only two. Actually more than most Miracle List play.
You know, Council's Judgment is such a nice card for this deck, just the flexibility. And its mana cost too, three mana.
Yep. It's nice for diversification for counterbalance purposes because there aren't a whole lot of threes that you can play in the deck.
Yep.
And just having some good catch-all answers to permanents, very good as well.
There's Life from the Loam. You can tell with Keating's deck, it can do a lot of different things. It can Loam, it has a small engine there, another Reliquary engine, punishing Fire Grove with a Burn Wheels engine, Dark Confidant has card advantage, and then it wants to lock out one mana spells as well. So it's looking to do a lot of things, honestly, a little helter-skelter.
There's a lot of sources of card advantage. If you count up the number of cards in each player's deck that can generate card advantage or even substantial card advantage, it's close. Keating might even have an edge if you were just counting that way, but Jace just does it in such a streamlined, powerful fashion against certain cards like Loam and Dark Confidant, which are much more contextual or something that Reed can interact with fairly easily.
There's Chalice again. I think Reed has Force Will and another Jace in hand, so he might fight over this.
Card's a pretty big long-term problem.
He's gonna let it go. Now here's a Dryad Arbor. And now we're gonna head back Duke's way. He'll untap those five lands. No top activation on the upkeep. Just a very quick draw step and then Brainstorm here from Jace. Keep his deck humming along. We've seen Reed a couple times here this weekend, and he does play this deck very quickly.
Yes.
Very important, especially in a matchup like this. It can go pretty long. It's a pretty grindy one. Scalding Tarn passed the turn back there for Duke.
And typically, Loam, Dark Confidant, Chalice guy settling in for quite the long game.
Yeah. Looking to lock you out. Dryad Arbor coming in. Gonna police that Jace a little bit. Bring it down to four counters. Cycle the Barrenmoor. Draw a card. Second Knight of the Reliquary was picked up again. That's the one card that Keating has not had the opportunity to deploy just yet. There's Wasteland. And now there's Knight. See if this is going to resolve or not. Could just see a hardcast Force Will, hardcast Counterspell, a couple different ways that Reed can take care of this, or simply just bouncing it with Jace.
Well, I think that Reed would, his strong preference here would be to continue to just Brainstorm, keep generating card advantage that way, and use counter spells to answer these threats. Once he starts bouncing things with Jace, the Jace is on a very short shelf life, and then Keating's card advantage, the fact that there's a Chalice on one in play, could become very problematic for Reed.
Wasteland's gonna go after Scalding Tarn here. It's an interesting target. And Reed's not gonna sack it. All right. Makes sense why.
Yes.
Little Terminus action.
Keating sniffed that one out. Very nice for him to get the tarn.
Yep. Reid gonna activate the brainstorm here on Jace. Two cards going back. It's counterbalance time. And it's this combination of cards on the battlefield here for Miracles. Top, counterbalance, and Jace, which makes it such a hard deck to beat.
Yep. For matchups like this especially.
Yep.
I mean, this is where Jace in particular. We've seen some matchups that Joe Lissette's played this weekend where Jace has felt a little bit too slow in the matchup. This is not such a matchup. If Reid can get Jace on the table, it's likely to be good. The board's going to be stable a good percentage of the time because Keaton doesn't apply a lot of pressure. And Reed's just been on two cards a turn versus one for a number of turns now.
Abrupt Decay going to go after counterbalance. There is Tranquil Thicket. And now Keating will just pass the turn back. Reid will spin the top. One thing you can tell in this matchup, the counterbalances aren't particularly safe because of Abrupt Decay. And there's not a lot of other things to Abrupt Decay in the matchup.
Yeah, this is a Jace matchup, not a counterbalance matchup. Soul Tie Control, very similar there as well. It's a deck with Abrupt Decay and a good spread of mana cost, so you're not really leaning on counterbalance. But Jace, if you can get into play, is excellent.
Over to Keating. As Reid has had that Jace out there for some time now, and it's very difficult to beat Miracles when it does have Jace running active as it is right now. There are card advantage engines in Keating's deck, like Life and Loam and Punishing Fire, but Reid feels the need to actually hardcast a Force Wall on that Life and Loam.
I mean, I'm sure Reid wants his mana, and also, I mean, it's Keating's entire turn. It's card advantage. I mean, you might as well fight over it.
Windswept Heat's going to bring Keating down to 21. There's a Bayou.
I think it's fine for Reid to trade one for one almost any way he can while he has Jason play and Keating has no analog.
Curious to see what's next here for Tom. He is running out of cards here. I think he might have another Knight of the Reliquary in hand. So he will deploy that, and I believe that may be the last card in his hand. Duke may be spinning the top end response. We'll see if Knight resolves or not. Take a look at the top couple. Well, Swords of Plowshares is in there. And Reed's actually going to sacrifice away the Flooded Strand. Search for a basic island and likely spin the top again. So after a shuffle and present here, we'll see what Duke wants to do. I imagine activate the top, and there is the mana for the activation, so we'll take a look at the top three. A copy of Terminus in there. It's a clean answer to the Knight. There's also a Sensei's Divine Top and a Force of Will. And now we're going to head back over to the Duke, and now here's the Terminus Miracle. So, Knight to the bottom, Jace going up. Duke going to Fate Seal himself.
And I like Fate Sealing himself there. There was a one on top of the deck that's locked out by Chalice. So it's pretty close to drawing a card in this spot, but he gets to move the loyalty on Jace up.
And that's part of the reason that previously, even though the Swords of Plowshares was on top, the Chalice for one, not an answer to the Knight that he saw previously. So here's a Loam Dredge, there's a Liliana, there's a Knight, there's actually another Knight.
The Loam is kind of an odd thing right now for Keating because it's not clear anything he gets out of this graveyard matters very much. But because Reid was willing to counter it the last time, it's kind of like, well, if he's going to counter any spell, I might as well guarantee a spell that he has to counter.
He's going to do it again.
Yep.
He very clearly does not want that spell to resolve as he's Force of Willed it twice now.
I'm not even sure Keating knows what that Loam ultimately leads to. But if Reid was willing to counter it before, might as well dredge and try again.
Here's a top activation from Duke. Jace the Mind Sculptor among those cards. One mana spells, not what he's looking for, though. He'll draw. And now he'll activate the Jace Brainstorm.
I think he wants to brainstorm this time because he found a Scalding Tarn inside the top cards, so he can shuffle away anything that's dead. Anytime that Reid can't shuffle away something, and there's a one involved in the mix, he's more likely to Fate Seal himself, get the Jace loyalty up, and still avoid drawing the one cost card.
Now it's Punishing Fire time. It's going to go after the Jace, so Jace is going to fall down to four. Keating will get it back with the Grove, and now he's going to Dredge Loam again. So Gaddock Teague, Knight of the Reliquary, and Chalice of the Void. Those will go to the graveyard. And there are the targets for Loam. But Loam is going to get countered again by a Hardcast Force of Will. Surprised you to see Reid countering it this much?
Not really, because Keating has a cycling land involved, so it's basically a wasteland plus another draw. And I'm not sure what else he's really going to be doing with these counter spells. At this point, it looks like his plan here is just to fend off Keating enough, long enough, to be able to find and treat the angels and win the game. So he can, if Keating's willing to use his turn dredging the Loam, and there's enough goodies in the graveyard, Duke can counter it. He's still drawing two cards a turn.
It feels like to me he's looking for entreat or counterbalance.
Yeah.
Counterbalance to check Punishing Fire, and then entreat to just get the game over with.
Yeah, if he gets counterbalance flow to two, all of a sudden Keating has to start taking draw steps,
yep.
And then he's just drawing very thin, so.
There's counterbalance. You saw Reid Fate Seal himself, too, put the card to the bottom again. Here's Punishing Fire.
And I'm starting to get a sense for the operations here from Duke. When he can shuffle away a one, he'll brainstorm. When he can't, he'll Fate Seal.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to learn some tricks of the trade here while I'm here.
Yeah. for when you pick up miracles,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah. Next Legacy tournament when I'm playing this deck, yep. You know, I'll have a better sense of some of the strategy.
Yeah. The day you play Miracles is the day I stop commentating on Magic. It's just not going to happen.
I feel like I owe the community some Divining Top activations.
Yeah.
I'm going to get mine back.
A dredge from Loam there.
I think Reid trying to get a count of the deck at this point.
Oh, new plan.
If it comes up, it comes up.
Yep.
I don't think it's the plan necessarily.
Reid going to spin top. Look for a two. Entreat the angels among those cards.
Yeah, now Reid might just be able to let this go. Maybe he counters it, maybe not, but.
And he's going to hardcast Force Will.
Entreat's the big payoff here.
Yep. There's Punishing Fire to go after Jace, down to two. Fate Seal himself, top card's gonna go to the bottom. The top card of his deck right now is Entreat the Angels.
Yeah, it's almost like he set it up this.
It's really strange.
And get Fate Seal himself,
yeah.
Now the Jace can survive the Punishing Fire.
See, the thing, Magic is a gate, it's all luck.
And he's playing very quickly also.
Yes, he is.
It's just, this is old hat for Reid Duke.
It is.
But I mean, he's 13 rounds in this tournament, he has no draws. And all, when we cover our regular Miracles players, there's always a draw or two scattered around the record, always.
I would want to see like a side-by-side video of him and Sam Raucus play.
Right, the Speed Magic?
Yeah.
Speed Miracles.
Almost no one plays it as quick as Sam. Reid is right up there, though.
Yeah.
When Raucus won his Open Series event last year, he didn't waste any time doing it. He had a dinner reservation or something. Check that, lunch reservation. It was that fast. Looks like Loam is resolved this time, but Reid doesn't care about Loam anymore.
Nope.
By all means, I found my win condition.
Get some lands back, cycle some whatever, don't worry about it. Now this is happening.
Yep, activate top to draw a card. You can't stop this. Reid will sacrifice Flooded Strand, and he's going to make a whole boatload of angels here. What's interesting to me, too, as we watch Reid make these angels, I don't think Keating has a way out of this. and he's going to concede the game. You know, every Miracles player is different to me, but Reid has always opted for very few creatures, oftentimes creatureless, and he just likes Entreat.
I prefer Reid's build of the deck to that of Joe Lissette's or some of the other creature-heavy ones. I think the major merit for playing with a lot of creatures is you get to play faster, you get to win games faster, but you can control that just by playing the games faster. And I think that Reid's deck is just much more synergistic with Sensei's Divining Top, Counterbalance, and Jace the Mind Sculptor, which is the root of the deck's power alongside the Miracle cards.
Reid Duke up a game here with Tom Keating Miracles, up a game over Punishing Obzon as we turn our attention to the sideboards here for both players. We'll start with Keating and his three Leyline of Voids, two Thoughtseize, two Thalia, Guardian of Thraben, bunch of one-ofs here in Containment Priest, Aethersworn Canonist, Reclamation Sage, Golgari Charm, Toxic Deluge, Engineered Plague, Garrick Relentless, and a Maelstrom Pulse.
It's not a great mixture of cards for this matchup. I think you can bring in the two copies of Thoughtseize. I think that you can bring in the two copies of Thalia, and the Garrick's okay, but not a lot of stuff to really change the matchup around.
Other side of things here for the Duke, he's got a Mountain of Pyroblast, two Red Elemental Blast, a Hydro Blast, Spell Pierce Flusterstorm, rest in peace, two Blood Moons, two Vendilion Clicks, a Bane Slayer Angel, a Supreme Verdict, and a Pin Needle. Actually, Blood Moon looks like it might be pretty good against Tom.
I love the Blood Moons, love the Supreme Verdict, and I can get down with Bane Slayer Angel in this matchup too.
Oh yeah.
His removal is what, Abrupt Decay? His creatures aren't really that big. I'm gonna bring in the Bane Slayer.
Punishing Fire?
Yeah.
Gonna take a few shots of that.
Good luck with that.
I can get behind Bane Slayer Angel here. Perhaps we'll see Duke bring
it. I think the one copy of Rest in Peace is also great. Don't want to overlook that. Keating's deck is Life from Loam, Knight of the Reliquary. It looks like a deck that just uses the graveyard a bunch. I think the one Rest in Peace will come in too.
Well, those are the options there for both players. Gannert will be underway in just a moment. Tom Keating will be on the play. In the meantime, we're going to talk the SCG newsletter. It is your source for Magic the Gathering news. StarCityGames.com/newsletters where you can go, and it's free to sign up for.
Absolutely. Best content for Star City Games cultivated by Cedric Phillips. Get the latest going-ons of the Open Series with a selected match of the week, exclusive deck lists and advice from premium columnists, and an exclusive cardboard crack comic. Best of all, signing up is free over at StarCityGames.com/newsletter.
Reid Duke is the player we are watching right now. So much success for him on the Open Series, Grand Prix, even Pro Tours as well. Odd to think that Reid only with one Pro Tour top eight to his name, but you have to imagine that second, third, maybe fourth one will be coming soon enough.
Absolutely. With the work that he puts in, the quality of the play, the skill of the people that he plays with, this resume is only going to be growing.
Five Invitational top eights with a win in Los Angeles a few years ago, eight Open Series top eights. Pretty low number, honestly. I expected to see a few more.
His conversion rate's pretty good.
Yeah, five W's. A Pro Tour top eight, a Pro Tour journey into Knicks a few years ago, and 15 Grand Prix top eights with three wins. I think we got to actually have the pleasure of the Grand Prix Miami one.
Yes,
in
we
2013.
Did.
That was a joy to watch. Worked several years as an assistant to a jeweler. Some of our fun facts about Reid here. Guest host of the 2008 Sugarloaf Awards and once beat Legend of Zelda Link to the Past without dying or using a fairy even once. I know you asked Reid a little bit about the Sugarloaf Awards. Some of our viewers may not have been with us, so give us a little explanation.
It's Reid's story to tell, so I don't want to be going into too much detail.
Understood.
But essentially, once a year, around New Year's, everyone, the residents of Sugarloaf and friends of Sugarloaf, get together. There's a committee, and they award these citizens and friends of Sugarloaf with various awards and acknowledgement for their year's worth of service to the community.
You're going to be Reid's plus one. Well, assuming he'll accept you.
I asked. I would like to throw myself out there as a friend of Sugarloaf, and I would like to go to this event. I'm willing to do, honestly, whatever it takes, because I am just so intrigued by this. But Reid and I talked in the hotel lobby yesterday evening in further detail about this, and it's just fascinating to me.
Do you think, like, now I believe that Sugarloaf, there's like a drawbridge to get in.
Right.
There's a moat. That's what it is. There's a moat to get in to the Sugarloaf. And, you know, who goes here?
You probably have to answer a series of riddles and then traverse the drawbridge, and then you're in the town, I'm guessing.
And once you're in, you're in.
Right, then you're a friend of Sugarloaf.
I imagine fresh fruits, bottled milk, everything
still
else.
Still definitely door-to-door milk delivery is
a
thing.
Yeah, yeah.
For sure.
The only good place left.
Yep.
and not anyone's allowed into the loaf. Here's a life from the loam. Reid gonna activate Sensei's Divining Top on the upkeep. Swords of Plowshares, the draw there is a Scalding Tarn. We're heading back Keating's way. Fern Catacombs here from Tom. He's going to go down to 19. We'll see what land he wants to search up. Again, Tom's deck does not have a lot of basic lands in it, so a card like Blood Moon is going to be very, very hard for him to beat.
Yeah, one forest in the deck. And that forest does not enable him to cast Abrupt Decay because he has a forest and a bunch of mountains. So unless he has Mox Diamond, it's a lock. He can't play through it.
Here's Liliana. A little bit of disruption here. See if this makes it in. Can be a problematic card.
My experience watching Miracles in Action is that Liliana is very powerful if they don't have Divining Top, but it's something the deck can play through if it does have Divining Top. The deck already plays so well off the top of its own deck that having its hand attacked is not necessarily the end of the world. Without Divining Top, without Jace, cards like him to Torak, any discard spells to Liliana, they can be very good.
Well, Reid gonna spin his top in response to Liliana going up to four. So both players will be discarding here in just a moment. Now Keating, to his credit, his deck works very well with Liliana. Mm-hmm. Punishing Fire, Life from the Loam, excess lands, all that stuff. Very solid Liliana deck. Dried Arbor down for Keating, Island down for Duke. I was curious to see if Reid would leave this card in, given the Abrupt Decays in the previous game, but he has. Does do a great job against Punishing Fire and a bevy of other things here from Tom. Though Keating already sliding a couple of lands over. Looks like maybe an Abrupt Decay on the way. He's going to start by cycling Barrenmoor. There's Grove of the Burn Willows. Yep, there's a Golgari Charm. Okay. Not quite Abrupt Decay. Reid will draw a card. And now Sacrifice. Let his top go pretty quick there.
Maybe he has a second copy.
Sure. Tundra.
I agree, though. That was a very fast move to get rid of the Divining Top.
Well, as I watch Reid play, nothing he does is by accident.
Yeah, I'm waiting to see the story unfold.
Yeah. Not. Here's Brainstorm.
This would also explain it if he has a two in his hand.
Duke gonna figure out what cards he wants to put back here. All right, counterbalance down.
Keating's got to be thrilled.
Yeah, I would be happy. Scalding Tarn down. There goes Punishing Fire. Pass the turn back. Duke will draw. He does have a Pith Needle in his hand. We'll play Sensei's Divining Top first. Now there's Needle. I imagine Liliana, if this resolves, but of course we'll get confirmation. And given the makeup of Keating's deck, it's not a long-term solution to Liliana. A lot of the times in Legacy, we see Pith Needle, and once that resolves and names something, it's gone for good.
Yeah.
And you're playing against a deck that has Abrupt Decay, so.
Sure. But at least, you know, at this point, nothing's really going on in the game, and Reid has Divining Top. He can play through Liliana even if the Pithy Needle goes away somewhere down the line.
Punishing Fire got returned by Keating on Duke's end step, and so now we're going to go to Tom's turn.
The history of control mirror matches in Magic is that the blue decks are good against the not blue decks. So as long as Reid can prevent anything catastrophic from resolving, he's going to win a longer game.
Keating in a dredged loam here. There's Life in the Loam. Targets there are Dryad Arbor, Baron Moor, and it looks like a fetch land. That'll resolve. See the clock here, we're under 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't think there'd be anything short about it. Two pretty grindy decks. And Keating is just trying to establish so many different things with his deck. Life in the Loam engine, Punishing Fire engine, Liliana being a distraction.
I mean, you can tell, even just by the way that Keating's playing his lands and the colored mana deal that's going on in his deck, even every land drop is not a short process
yep.
for him to figure out what land he wants to put into play.
He's fetching now. And he's going to get himself a Taiga. Now there's neither reliquary. Duke will spin his top.
Interesting there that Reid did not make an effort to go get the mountain. I would imagine his Blood Moons are in this matchup.
Yeah, but you know what's interesting too is, right, he's actively searched out two non-basics.
Yeah.
In the two Tundras. And we have seen, we've watched Reid play so far this weekend, is he's been searching up basics like crazy.
Yes.
So maybe the Blood Moons aren't in. No guarantee, even though I do think Blood Moon's pretty good in this matchup. There's Rest in Peace. We know that one's good in the matchup.
Mm-hmm.
Their Source of Plasters take care of the knight. So one thing I think Reid's doing a nice job of in this game is he's overloading Abrupt Decay.
Yes.
Says if you have Abrupt Decay, you got to choose between Counterbalance, you got to choose between Needle, Rest in Peace, maybe some other permanents we're not even thinking of yet.
And there's just so few relevant cards in Keating's deck. Most of the deck is set up. In terms of actually winning the game, there's very, very little here. And a lot of it's predicated on the graveyard being there. He's just drawn a Loam. I believe his hand has a Punishing Fire in it. Punishing Fire went from way to contain Jason a long game to shock for two mana.
There's Chalice. And there's a Dryad Arbor. And now Reed's going to spin his top. Over to Duke we go. As Keating is trying to get his pieces in place, Duke is trying to do the exact same. They both play the role of pretty unique control decks with kind of prison elements in them.
But Reid, even though he's not in as firm a position as he was last game, he he's still in the same spot where if he finds Jace or Entreat with a couple more land drops, it blows up the whole game.
Yep. Council's Judgment took care of that Chalice on one.
Keating's ability to be the control deck in this matchup, it can happen, but it's very tenuous because Jace and Entreat are so much more powerful in that sort of game than anything Keating brings to the table.
There's Caracas. Here comes Dryad Arbor. Now here's Sylvan Library.
Okay, this is a good one.
That's something.
So definitely a good one.
Reid gonna spin the top. Source of Plowshares among those top three cards. Over to Duke. He'll spin top again. Spell Pierce among them. Draw a card with the top. Wonder what we got coming now. Just play another top, pass the turn back. Whenever I see a play like that from Reid, I'm thinking, all right, what am I missing?
I think he just wanted to hit his land drop.
Fair enough.
He just wants a land into play. He's playing towards Entreat, so every land that he gets in play
sure
is good for him. He doesn't have to draw the top next turn. He just simply sends that to the bottom if he doesn't want to redraw it. So it costs him nothing and lets him put a land into play.
When you watch someone of Reid's caliber make unique plays like that with Miracles and his tops, and you know, a lot of the times when we watch Miracles players play with tops, they hold on to tops like they are precious gold.
Yes.
Which, to be fair, they are with this deck.
Yeah, but Reid had one to spare. Yep. So, you know.
Maelstrom Pulse. That's the one in the sideboard, if memory serves.
Yes.
Gonna go after the needle. Keating wants his Liliana back. Reid is going to spin the top. Look at Spell Pierce. That ain't going to get it done.
Nope. Spell Pierce is an unfortunate card that Reid has to kind of leave in the deck because of Chalice and Liliana the Veil. But these games also will go on for a long time, and Spell Pierce is quite poor past a certain point.
Needle down. Liliana up. And that's going to do it right there.
Yep.
Reid is going to concede the game. I think he's in too much trouble because of Liliana.
Well, he knows what he's drawing because of the Divining Top. He has no way to shuffle. And he just knows it's a matter of time. He's so far behind in terms of resources. A fast concession there, but, you know, Reid is aware. It's pretty hopeless. 12 minutes left on the clock. That's enough time for him to win a game three, even with his build being a little bit on the slower side. But if he runs it down to, say, 6 minutes trying to play that one out, he can't get game three.
I suppose the question to be asked, too, is that enough time for Tom Keating to win?
That's a good question. His deck's also, you know, quite slow, as we saw. But I think if you run the clock down to 5-6 minutes, it's a lock that it's going to be a draw. And a draw here knocks both players out of top eight.
Well, both players are going to shuffle up pretty quickly here for game number three, I imagine. Reid Duke will be on the play. See if he's going to bring Blood Moons in or anything like that as he's kind of making his way through his deck. But in the meantime, we will talk about the Star City Games YouTube page, where you can go back and watch the replay of this match, all the matches from this weekend, and a whole bunch more.
Yeah, a lot of old content from throughout the years, including Versus Series videos, Premium Archives, Open Series Archives, and content that's exclusive to the YouTube page, like unboxings. You can head over to youtube.com/StarCityGames to become a subscriber today and get notified when new content is uploaded to the page.
Duke v. Keating. Round number 14, about 10 minutes left to play. A draw, horrible.
Yep.
Right now for both players. One of them needs a win to be able to keep their top eight dreams alive. And join Chris Anderson in the elimination rounds. He's our only person in right now. Playing lands this weekend. Chris coming into this round was 12-1. So congratulations to him on what's a very important top eight berth. But top eight's not good enough. That's just step one of many for Chris. And step one for potentially Reid Duke here to play spoiler to Chris, as he's already done once this tournament.
And if I got a look at things, it appeared as though Reid bailed on the counterbalances going to game three. We know he had him for game two. I think they got cut. They were at least separated as he was sideboarding. Don't know if they left the deck, but it looked like he was at least giving them a once over.
Both players going to keep. It's going to be a little bit of speed magic here. We'll try to keep up as Duke does start off with a Tundra. Verdant Catacombs here for Keating. Duke will draw. Jace the Mind Sculptor the first draw. So Flooded Strand and a passing of the turn. Keating will take a draw step here. He'll sacrifice that Verdant Catacombs. See what land Tom wants to search up. Searching lands in his deck is not easy.
No. It's four colors. I mean, he's got Badlands and Savannah, so.
Looks like he's going to go with Scrubland that appears.
I occasionally have to check there's the rare four-color decks where I have to make sure that the fetch land can get the dual land.
Yep. There's Dark Confidant. Duke is going to brainstorm a response to Dark Confidant. See if he's looking for a sword, a counterspell, what have you. He does have a fetch land to make it a solid brainstorm here.
His Windswept Heaths cannot get Badlands. And other than that, I think he can... All of his fetches work for all the duels.
Duke will now sacrifice Flooded Strand. Basic or non-basic? That's the question. Basic Plains. Duke will quickly untap. Go to his third turn. Take a draw step. Does have Council's Judgment in hand. Also, Swords of Plowshares, it appears. Swords will take care of Dark Confidant. Keating will gain some life up to 21. We're heading back Tom's way. Tom will take a draw. It's a Caracas, and it's a Liliana. This one was a game winner for Keating.
Although this time, Reid gets to fire back next turn with Jace the Mind Sculptor if he wants it. Did not have that tool last game.
Time to discard. Supreme Verdict down for Reid. Verdant Catacombs down for Tom. Duke will draw. Picked up a fetch land. Looks like he'll be sacking his two fetches. You mentioned Jace the Mind Sculptor, and I think it might be on the way. One basic island. I think it'll be two of them. Yep.
And he does have the Blood Moons. They're in.
There is Jace. It'll be a brainstorm. And I like the brainstorm here from Reid because given what he has seen thus far in the match, mostly the Chalice on one, leads you to believe my opponent does not have Lightning Bolt.
If I was Reid, I'd be shocked if Lightning Bolt was in my opponent's 75, and I would be even more surprised if it was still in their deck.
Yep.
So I'm happy to brainstorm. Game one, I thought it made sense to hedge a little bit.
Garrick Relentless. It's a Planeswalker battle, folks.
Okay. A duel of four mana Planeswalkers. One slightly less celebrated than the other.
This one brings a 2-2 green wolf to the battlefield. And now Liliana's going to make both players discard. Island down here for Reid. Keating going to discard a loam. We do have wolf tokens. Over to Duke. Which Planeswalker is best? I guess we're going to find out. I think we know the answer, but we'll see what happens here. Duke will brainstorm.
And I think Reid may have found Blood Moon.
And Arid Mesa.
At least Keating has some stuff going on the board. It's not just game over, but Blood Moon's definitely bad news for him. And I love Reed's gone through some incredible pains here to conceal red mana from Keating over the course of these three games. I don't know if Blood Moon's on his radar at all.
The thing to know about Blood Moon right now, and I agree that it's quite good, It does cut one of Reed's white sources.
Yep.
And prevents counsel's judgment. Now, you know, you make the argument of, yeah, he'll find another white source eventually. He's got a Jace out there.
Well, he might have to counsel his judgment one of these planeswalkers away this turn anyway. He may not have the luxury of casting Blood Moon this turn. May have to wait a little bit.
It looks like it will be counsel's judgment. Liliana, it's got to go. Liliana will have to be exiled, of course. Can't be having that in the graveyard, given Council's Judgment. So there we are. Now he'll dredge alone. Sylvan Library is one. Life and Loam is two. Gaddock Teague is three. You see Keating's mana base. No basic forest out there just yet. Here comes the wolf. Bring Jace down to one. The follow-up is Life and Loam. Keating will get back a couple of fetch lands. Two Verdant Catacombs, to be exact. He'll play one. Sack it. See what land he wants to search up. Curious to see if he's going to search up the basic forest, as now here is Thalia with Caracas at the ready, and he will get the basic forest. Smart play there from Tom. Another wolf token. 4 minutes to go as Duke is untapping. Force of Will to draw, a little late.
Looks like Reed's leftovers here. Tarn, Blood Moon, Force of Will, Snapcaster Mage.
So let's start by sacking the Tarn. Remember, Duke is not the creature-heavy build of this deck. He prefers to go basically creatureless. So he searches up a basic mountain.
I think Reed has set this game up very well insofar as if he can find Entreat, it probably ends the game.
He'll Fate Seal himself. Top card going to stay on top. Here's Snapcaster Mage. Council's Judgment. That's the solution to... Garrick, I believe. Yep. All right, pass it back. About 2:30 to left to go. Here come the beatdowns on Jace. The Snapcaster Mage will trade with the Wolf. And there's Knight of the Reliquary. Pass the turn back. Blood Moon's in the clear now. Another Council's Judgment to draw. There is Council's Judgment. Get Knight out of here.
Yeah, I mean, Reed is just happy to slow the game down here a little bit. Does not want to take a huge shot from Knight of the Reliquary next turn.
Yeah, I think the thought here is I can handle Thalia and a Wolf.
Right, that's a lot of draw steps.
Yep. Terminus is a nice solution to that. Entreat's a great solution. If Keating doesn't do anything too punishing this turn, Blood Moon's looking pretty nice. Keating will draw a card. I think he may have found another Knight here. He'll start by cycling Barrenmoor. Draw a mystery card. Here come the beatdowns for five. Duke's going to fall down to 10. What's interesting here is I feel like Tom kind of wants to pace things and not run into a Terminus, but I think he's just got to deploy stuff.
Yeah, I think it's really risky here to just leave stuff in your hand.
Top. Spin. Swords of Plowshares is there. Draw that. Got to cast that. Get Knight out of here again. Keating will gain some amount of life here, but... getting the Knight off the battlefield, pretty important here for Duke, and we're going to head back over to Keating. I do like Keating's position right now.
Well, Reed did not have a great sampling cards there through the Divining Top. I think he gets basically one fresh look next turn, and I think it's got to be Terminus.
Loam, going to be dredged. Barrenmoor among them. You see Keating picking up the pace here. They're under a minute. Couple copies of Barrenmoor. Here come the beatdowns. Lone will have to cost one more mana here because of Thalia. So they do fix that as the players are playing pretty quickly. Reid going to redeploy top. It's going to cost two. Spin that top. And that is going to do it. Tom Keating is going to win this match here over Reid Duke. 2-1. Punishing Obzon. Going to take care of Miracles. Bit of an upset here, but impressive match played there by Tom Keating.
Well, instead of Keating trying to hold on to the game the whole time, like he kind of did in the first couple of games, he applied some pressure on the board and never really gave Reid the breathing space. I mean, Reid had Blood Moon in his hand the whole game, and yeah, the board was never stable enough for him to play it, even though Keating's spells would have gotten locked out.